I'm sitting on the couch. Next thing you know, I got like 3 9-millimeters just pointed directly in my face. I'm like, what is this about? Why is you coming in with guns drawn for? They laid us on the ground. Out of everybody, they picked me. I said, okay, what's going on? I'm saying, do you know who this detective is? I'm like, no. He said, this guy is Columbo. I said, Columbo? He said, yeah, have you ever seen the TV series Columbo? I said, yeah, growing up, I done watched Columbo a few times. He said, so you know Columbo always gets his man. So I'm telling you right now, you will be found guilty.
The American criminal justice system enforces our laws and keeps watch over us.
Is that person in the courtroom now?
But who is watching the system? I'm Joe Berlinger, and I've used my camera for 20 years to knock down doors and pursue the truth. Now we're going inside the American criminal justice system.
Any comments on the charges?
From law enforcement to elected officials, the court system to corrections, to find out if justice is being served.
You know, every day in this country, thousands of suspects are identified by eyewitnesses, but a shocking number of these eyewitnesses get it wrong. In fact, in all of the DNA exonerations that have happened to date, 70% of them have involved faulty eyewitness identification. But what happens when there's no DNA evidence involved in a case?
In Dallas, Christopher Scott spent 13 years in prison trying to get to the bottom of that question.
Man, I was working, taking care of my family, always home enough to feed my kids, put them to bed, take them to school. I was the average guy. And when I went in jail, I was like, they gotta be kidding me.
Christopher Scott's case is one of the hundreds that have been reinvestigated by the Dallas County District Attorney's Office. James Hammond led the investigation.
Here at this location, two gentlemen went in to purchase some drugs, gunfire ensued, and the resident at this house was killed. When the police arrived, they were looking for suspects in the area, two black males, one tall, one short. The victim witness, Cecilia Escobedo, had given that description. It was reported that she awoke and there were two men in the house. The spouse had just been murdered. Happened pretty quick.
Within minutes, police cars descended upon the scene on the lookout for two suspects.
An officer passed another car that had two black males in it. He turned around, shined their light on them as they pulled into their driveway off of Kenwell. Saw that there was a tall one and a shorter one, which matched the vague description given by Cecilia Escobedo, and called for backup.
Christopher Scott was in that car along with a friend named Claude Simmons.
Next thing you know, I got like 3 9-millimeters just pointed directly in my face. I'm like, what is this about? Why is you coming in with guns drawn for? Well, you just need to come outside and we'll get everything situated. And if everything is okay, then we'll let you go.
They ended up taking Chris into custody. We're going to take him down to the police station, interview him down there. And if he didn't have anything to do with it, they told him he'd be released.
I was just concerned about why I was being put inside of a police car and haven't did anything.
Christopher Scott's fate, literally his life, would hang upon whether or not an eyewitness could correctly identify him. An eyewitness of a different race who had just seen a high-impact home invasion robbery and murder go down in a matter of seconds.
This is when I seen a plot thicken. They put me in front of a big glass window, door light, handcuffed me to the bench. But everybody else in the room was pushed on the other side where they couldn't see these individuals. They can only see me. And my head was down because I'm tired. It's early in the morning. I raise up. That's when I see the cop walk the lady up and say, this is the guy that killed your husband. I'm behind the glass window, but I can see like I'm seeing you. And I read her lips. I say, now I know she didn't just say what I thought she said. She said, see, because she was Hispanic. There's him. There's him.
While Christopher Scott's nightmare inside Dallas County's criminal justice system was just beginning, another inmate in New Orleans was already 11 years deep into a life sentence. In 1984, George Toka was identified by two witnesses, both of them white, who accused Toka of accidentally shooting his best friend, Eric Batiste, during the course of a robbery.
These two young men were together all of the time, all of the time. If you saw George, you saw Eric. And when you saw Eric, you saw George.
Marlon DeFillo was on active duty on the day of the murder.
Your victims came out of the facility store, and they were parked here. And as they walked to the car, they were confronted by two suspects, at least one holding a gun, and they demanded property and money.
While the gunman held the female robbery victim on the driver's side of the car, Eric Batiste began to struggle with the male victim. The gunman panicked, fired a shot at the passenger, and hit Eric Batiste in the head.
So when I had received that information that Eric was dead, the first name came to mind was George Toka.
A few hours later, Marlon DeFillo arrested George Toka. The next day, the two witnesses identified Toka using this photo lineup provided by the New Orleans Police Department.
I'm going to show you some photographs, and I should take a look at those and see if you can identify any of those photographs.
That was one I picked out that morning.
George Toka claims he was never there. He told police that he spent the night in this motel after attending a high school dance at the Superdome. Toka saw Eric Batiste leave the dance with another young man who fits the description of the gunman given by the witnesses. But police didn't buy his story. They had eyewitnesses.
When you have an eyewitness said to say, I was there, I saw him do it, I saw him in this robbery, that is the best evidence.
In 1985, Toka was tried, found guilty of murder, and sentenced to life. He's doing hard time in one of the toughest places in the country, Louisiana's Angola prison. 29 years later, George's sister Sandy is still convinced that he's innocent.
I think about George all the time, all day long. You know, he's on my mind when I wake up. It's like, you know, I thank God. I say my prayers and I always pray for my brothers. God cover him in such a horrific environment, you know, and just keep his mind, you know, keep his sanity. I remember getting the news and falling all off the porch, falling all down in the street and, you know, just crying out to God, like, why, how? You know, this is unbelievable. If he was guilty of the crime, then I can rest. Because at least I know you've been there for something that you have to pay your price for. Well, from a 17-year-old child to a 48-year-old man for a crime that you didn't commit.
Sandy has never given up on her brother, but she's not battling the system alone. In fact, she has the kind of support rarely found in a murder case, the support of the victim's family.
He's being falsely accused, incarcerated for something he did not do, and at such a young age.
Joyce Dolio's nephew was Eric Batiste, the man George Toka was convicted of murdering.
Two loving brothers. You know, they couldn't have been closer. No one is listening to us that George is innocent.
Each day, each year is going to be the year that, you know, finally he gets the chance to prove his innocence where he can't come home.
And until we get that, for us, my family, we can't finalize Eric's death because we don't have the satisfaction of the person that did it being punished for it, and that somebody else that wasn't guilty, whole life is going down the drain for something he didn't do.
George Toka's case raises troubling questions about the procedures used by police to obtain accurate eyewitness identifications. Many of these practices have been in place for years, but now they are being put to the test.
So we're here at John Jay College of Criminal Justice in Manhattan to see Dr. Jennifer Dicer. We're gonna do some experiments in eyewitness identification. And I kind of love coming to criminal justice schools and meeting with young people because they haven't yet lost their idealism and they still have a strong belief in the system. It's good to remind yourself of what the system can be. Hi, Joe Berlinger.
Jennifer Dicer, pleasure to meet you.
Nice to meet you. So tell us what we're going to do today.
Absolutely. So I'm an eyewitness identification researcher. I've been studying the factors that influence eyewitness reliability for about 15 years. And so I thought today we would run you through an experiment so you can see how the research is conducted.
Great. And how accurate are eyewitness identifications, you know?
Studying not only people in the research lab, but also witnesses in the real world. About 30% of the time, witnesses in real cases who pick someone and say, yes, that's the person who committed the crime, are wrong. And I actually have a demonstration, if I can,
I
can show you
real quick.
So here's an example that I'd like to show you. We call it the penny example. And the instructions I'll give you is, I'd like you to take a look at this and tell me which one is the real penny.
Hmm. I would say that is it.
Number four.
Yeah.
What most people do, if they don't immediately recognize the person, they go to the second process, which is, can I figure it out? Like a multiple choice question. And so they'll eliminate a bunch, 1, 2, and 3, those are gone. 10, 11, and 12 are often gone, those in the opposite direction. And at the end of the day, people narrow down their options and pick the one that is the best. And we, researchers, call that relative judgment. Relative to the others, you pick the one that's the best.
In fact, now I want to switch to number 5.
You're going to switch to number 5? Number 5 is actually the most commonly chosen penny. But this also demonstrates another very important principle for witnesses in real cases, and that is law enforcement are supposed to tell the witness that the real perpetrator, or penny, may or may not be there. So that none of the above in the multiple choice question really is an option.
Hmm.
And here, none of them are actually the real penny.
Ah, you didn't tell me that.
I did not tell you that. Just like many law enforcement officers, because it's not part of their policy and they're not mandated to do so, don't tell witnesses in advance. Keep in mind, we might not have the right guy, right? The real perpetrator may not be here. That's not part of their repertoire.
What Jennifer Dysart and other leading researchers believe is that the identification procedures used by the majority of the police departments in this country are outmoded and unscientific. That was the case in Dallas in 1997. A witness had just identified Christopher Scott as the man who shot and killed her common-law husband during a robbery.
And he said, you know you committed this crime. I'm like, what crime is that, sir? You never even told me what I was being booked for. So I said, I'm not answering no more questions until you tell me why am I here. Typical cop stuff, cigarette in a soft drink. Tell me what you know. So I said, well, I have to use the restroom. May I be excused to use the restroom? He said, yeah, of course, you can't go nowhere. So I know when you're in one of those rooms and when you walk out, you look up. Whatever room you in, this is what they saying you probably done did or whatever. So when I walked up and looked up, I seen homicide.
April 15th, 1985, two eyewitnesses testify they see George Toca accidentally shoot his best friend, Eric Batiste, during the course of an armed robbery.
The president told you that. Get out of the car and give it to you. Do you see him in the car on the deck?
Yes, sir, I do see it over to the right.
This individual here?
Yes, sir.
Let the record reflect that identification of the defendant.
Toca was convicted and has spent more than half of his life in prison. He maintains that he's innocent. He agreed to talk with us about his case during his weekly phone call to his family.
Hey, call from?
George.
An inmate at the Louisiana State Penitentiary. Mm-hmm. You may start the conversation now.
Hello?
Hey, chicken.
Hi, George.
How you doing? How y'all doing?
We okay. How you?
I'm good. I'm good.
Everybody's here.
All right. Thank you for coming and everything you're doing. Well, as you can see from the case files and everything my family and my lawyers have told you, you can see that I'm innocent of this crime. I did kill my best friend. You know, it's clearly a case of mistaken identity. Unfortunately, guilt by association. Just being a friend of Eric Batiste, somebody I love, and we grew up together. The suspect who committed the crime was much taller than I am, 5'10", 140 pounds with no gold teeth. And I allowed myself to be arrested to clear my name and see that I was not the taller suspect.
Toca believes that because he is black and the eyewitnesses against him were white, the odds were stacked against him in a place like New Orleans.
Did you notice anything distinguishing about the individual?
The only thing I remember is that he had darker skin than the other boy. He had a darker complexion than the other boy.
Did you give a height, a weight?
He said around 5'10", 135 pounds.
The female witness got the closest look at the shooter. She picked out George Toca from a photo lineup. But Toca believes when the witness saw him in court, she realized her mistake.
I think she's really motivated by anger from the beginning all up to trial. I think when she saw me in prison and up close and with the gold teeth, I really believe in my heart that she realized that I was not the total suspect. I don't understand why she hasn't come forward or had the courage or whatever, done the right thing all these years.
Toka is still amazed how both witnesses continue to stand by their stories.
Things happen so fast, as he said in his statement. He didn't get a good look at the suspect. But I think when he first saw me at the motion space, I was too small to be the taller guy. So if you study his statements, you'll see that he didn't get a good look, and he couldn't make a pile of them case.
You have 1 minute left.
All I can say is, by the grace of God, somebody gonna come forward, or somebody gonna, you know, get involved and really go the extra mile and really find the evidence or get somebody, you know, to do the right thing. All right, y'all take care. I love y'all. I'll call y'all later on this week.
Okay, I love you too.
Bye-bye, bye-bye.
Bye.
Innocence Project New Orleans has always taken on difficult cases. Cases that take years and years and years to win. We took on George's case because he's innocent. It's very clear. I think most lay people looking at the case can see that he didn't do the crime.
Emily Maw is the director of the Innocence Project in New Orleans. Since 2001, she and her staff have helped win the exoneration of 20 wrongfully convicted inmates.
George Toka's conviction is based exclusively on a cross-racial identification by two witnesses who were exposed to a procedure by the New Orleans Police Department that has been proven time and time again in every way that the police department conducted it to increase inaccuracy in identification.
The Innocence Project is arguing that the state willfully ignored those inconsistencies and has suppressed efforts to give Toka a new trial.
As a lawyer who is frequently challenging convictions when there is new evidence of innocence, courts still look to an eyewitness and say, but the eyewitness identified him. It baffles me that happens, given what we know now about the potential problems with eyewitness identification.
In the last 10 years, cognitive psychologists like Jen Dysart have been shattering the myths surrounding eyewitness identification.
There are like some basic beliefs that I think a lot of people have. Why would somebody falsely confess, or how could you misidentify somebody?
The fascinating thing about the whole system and the process is that, generally speaking, these are mistaken witnesses who really believe they're accurate. They're not lying.
Today, Dysart has invited a group of students to her offices at John Jay College to demonstrate how police procedures work and how witnesses behave. The students have been told they will be participating in a social science study, but that's all they've been told. They have no clue about what is going to happen next. Something that takes place here will turn them from innocent bystanders into witnesses.
So you're just going to be watching a video and then answer a few questions about it. You'll all have to fill out some informed consent first, just to give your consent to be a part of this study. And it's looking like I don't actually have the informed consent. So let me just go grab that. I'll be right back. You guys just sit tight for a second.
Does anybody know Vicky?
Yeah, she just stepped out. Yeah.
She just stepped out. I'm here to pick up a laptop. I'm from IT. So I imagine that's the laptop?
I hope so.
Thank you.
Okay, so we can get started. I've got my forms. Have you guys seen my laptop?
Your friend came and picked it up.
My friend?
Looking for Vicky.
I have no idea who that was. I think someone just stole my laptop. I guess I should call security. Okay, as you guys have probably guessed already, this is part of the experiment. And the person that was here, we're gonna pretend that was an actual theft, that he stole the laptop.
So what's gonna happen now?
What's gonna happen is we're gonna bring participants back one at a time. We're going to ask them to give a description of the criminal who stole the laptop, and then we would show them some photographs to see if they can make a correct ID decision.
Okay, let's bring them on.
The line of questioning utilized here is consistent with the questions that law enforcement use with real eyewitnesses, starting with the physical attributes of the suspect.
So as much as you can remember about what he looked like, what he was wearing, any details really that you can remember.
What I can remember is that he was wearing a blue, I think he was wearing a blue collar under his black sweater.
White collar, tall. Okay.
5'9"-ish. 5'10"-ish.
Okay. His hair is like kind of grayish, not too gray though.
White hair.
Brown hair.
And blue jeans.
Black pants, brown shoes.
He was a little bit over medium built.
He was a little heavy.
I don't really remember his facial features, but his eyes were gray.
When you think about it, most of these answers are pretty vague. In fact, they could have been describing just about any middle-aged white man in America. And think about the real-world cases we have. Two African-American men accused of violent crimes that took place in a matter of seconds. The men were also identified by witnesses of a different race. Research has shown these cross-racial identifications can be biased. When eyewitness cases are overturned, 40% of the time the witnesses who got it wrong were members of a different race.
What went wrong in my case, they had a Hispanic lady saying she remembered seeing a black guy killed. You know, that cross-racial thing. You looking at low haircut, dark complected, middle age, medium height. How many black men in America are you describing when you describe it? You describe over most majority of the men in America.
They say there are 2 days in a prison sentence, the day you go in and the day you go home. For Christopher Scott, that first day never should have happened.
When I say my throat dropped to my stomach, I mean exactly that's what had happened. I took it on the chin. She'll say, if there's anything you want to say, I say, yes, ma'am. I say, y'all convicted the wrong man. And believe me when I tell you this, I will be back to fight my case. This is not over.
Back in New York at our eyewitness identification experiment, a laptop has been stolen and the witnesses have already given conflicting descriptions of the suspect. The next step is for the investigator, in this case, Vicky, to show the witnesses a lineup. This is how most police departments do it. It's called a six pack, six pictures on one page.
So the next thing I'm gonna do is I'm gonna show you a lineup, six people, and I just want you to try to find which one he is, okay?
Okay. He looked more like the guy on the bottom right.
Okay, do you think that's him?
Yeah, I think that's him.
In the bottom right?
Mm-hmm.
Do you feel confident?
I feel very confident that it was that guy.
That it was that guy?
Yeah.
Okay. That was bad.
Bad technique?
Yes.
Okay, why do we call it bad technique?
Well, it's not a recommended police practice. First, all of the individuals were presented at the same time. What this tends to result in is witnesses who compare the photos and pick the one who's the best. And you could actually almost hear that in the language, mm-hmm. where he kind of settled on number six.
This is just one of the potential errors made by the New Orleans Police Department in the case against George Toca. The department has become notorious for outmoded police tactics and corruption. Toca was given a life sentence for the murder of his best friend, Eric Batiste, during the commission of a robbery.
The way that the police conducted this procedure was in every way flawed, creating an inaccurate identification of an innocent suspect, in this case, George Toca. So this here is the six-pack. You can see here, this is George Toca, and these are the fillers that they used.
At the time of the shooting, both witnesses described the gunman as being tall and having a medium build. George Toca is 5'5" and weighed just over 100 pounds. It's one of several inconsistencies in the accounts given to the police by the eyewitnesses.
What's interesting is you can't see heights from here. You can't see very clearly whether or not George Toca has gold teeth, four very prominent gold teeth at the front. In a crime where the person who ultimately shot Eric Batiste is supposed to have spoken, there is no way that if that person was George Toca, they would not have noticed his gold teeth.
As we are seeing in these identification experiments, it's easy for eyewitnesses to give inaccurate information.
I got a good look of his eyes, at least, or like the way he looks.
The Innocence Project's case goes much further. It accuses the New Orleans Police Department of perverting justice by mishandling the entire eyewitness identification procedure.
There is no evidence in the record at all that they were told when they were shown this photo lineup that the perpetrator or, you know, the suspect may or may not be in this lineup. That is very important to do, and there has been significant research bearing this out. It's one of the things that the Department of Justice recommends all law enforcement agencies do.
The New Orleans Police Department declined our request to comment on this case. Going back to the experiment, here's the six-pack photo lineup that was shown to the witnesses. But would their choice have been affected if they were told originally that the actual suspect is not pictured here?
He also was not told in advance that the actual person who stole the laptop may or may not be there. So he's led to believe, induced to believe, that he's supposed to pick someone.
He looked more like the guy on the bottom right.
Inducing or guiding a witness to make a decision is a major flaw in the witness identification system. And the next witness here in this experiment is proof of how this can happen.
I think the guy in the middle bottom looks the closest.
Okay.
But I'm not confident that that's really him.
That's the guy that we think is the person too.
Okay. Like he's the closest.
He's the closest, yeah. That you think? So you can see the witness starting to change their identification decision.
Because of some subtle pressure.
Absolutely.
In Dallas, the eyewitness identification procedure used in Christopher Scott's case was a powerful tool for the prosecution, despite its many flaws.
They took me straight to my lawyer, and he told me, say, look, this is capital murder. I'm like, okay, what is that? He say, that's either life or death. I say, life or death? What you mean? He say, exactly what I just said. They can either kill you or give you a life sentence.
And with no forensic evidence to lean on, the prosecution put all of its weight behind the testimony of its star witness.
I couldn't believe she was saying what she was saying. Because it's like a play, it's like a movie. When you see the prosecutor doing his thing with his witness, leading her into all of her questions. Well, ain't this the guy that did this? Is this the guy that did that? And she said, yeah, that's him. I remember him. I would never forget him. He ruined my life. I couldn't believe it.
According to George Toka, the real person who shot and killed his friend Eric Batiste in New Orleans is still on the streets.
All right, well, the guy, my neighborhood friend, I believe he did it based on the fact that that's who I left Eric with in the dance. I mean, when they bought the gun, for some marijuana, Eric was living with them. You know, I believe he the one that did it, and he the one I left Eric with. He the one fit the description.
George's sister Sandy had heard rumors about this suspect in the neighborhood, but as the years went by, she couldn't find anyone who would be willing to talk about it on the record. Then she got a call from a girlfriend who remembered that a guy she was dating at the time of the murder had shown up, visibly shaken by something that had just happened to him.
She said that morning he came over to the house and, you know, he had on these bloody clothes and, you know, girl, I got up, I was so scared, I ain't know what's going on. And as she talking, I literally dropped the phone. But why would you keep that from me, knowing that's my brother's life on the line we talking about? I didn't know at the time a whole lot about the law. You know, but at the same time, I know I needed to do something to help my brother. At least get some type of attention, talk to somebody that's involved or somebody that knows somebody, because everything in New Orleans is connections.
Sandy went back to the Lafitte housing complex where she and George grew up. It was a high crime area and a tough place to get information about an old case, especially a case that pointed a finger at the police.
New Orleans is one of the worst police force in America. And it has been like that for years. Ever since I can remember from being a young kid, everybody were petrified. We grew up in a project, you wouldn't even call the police. You understand? People would try to handle things on their own because they have this sign to protect and serve, but it wasn't no protection. Not a service they were providing, and it wasn't no service to where it would benefit you. So you never felt safe. It was so much police brutality. These kids just started literally growing up with this almost hatred in their heart for the police department.
The New Orleans police engaged in a pattern or practice of conduct that was both discriminatory and unconstitutional, and that too often undermined the public's trust and the city's efforts to effectively prevent crime.
In March of 2011, the Justice Department released the findings of a two-year investigation of the New Orleans police.
The report found that New Orleans police used too much force against civilians, too often didn't report it, and often failed to investigate the use of force thoroughly. It noted that African Americans were disproportionately arrested when compared to white citizens.
The report was explosive. It found some of the most widespread dysfunction and corruption in the history of big city policing in America.
Now today, the Justice Department and the City of New Orleans filed a consent decree to ensure that local police services are delivered in a manner that is effective and complies with the Constitution and the laws of the United States.
It's an extreme measure. At 126 pages, the federal consent decree is aimed at correcting long-standing patterns of police misconduct. And it specifically requires the New Orleans Police Department to completely overhaul its eyewitness identification procedures. But as far as George Toka's lawyers are concerned, there is little evidence of change.
We have a district attorney's office here that has said publicly, if all we've got is one eyewitness, I'm willing to take that case to trial. One piece of evidence that has been shown to be one of the most unreliable kinds of evidence in criminal cases, where the consequences in many of these trials are life without parole. I think that is a huge disservice to the citizens of this city.
If George Toka and his supporters are looking for hope that justice will come to New Orleans, they can take a look at the city of Dallas and what happened to another inmate stuck in the system, Christopher Scott. He had nearly given up hope when he showed his case to a jailhouse lawyer.
And he read it, and he made fun of me one time, and he was like, dude, there's nowhere in the world you're gonna get out of prison. You got a million and one chance. I'm like, why you say that? He say, for one, you have no DNA in your case. Somebody has to come back and say that they actually committed this crime before you get released. And I told him, I said, you know what? I'm gonna be that one out of a million to get out of prison for this non-DNA case. I'm laying in bed, I'm trying to figure out my next best move that I can make. And all of a sudden, Craig Watkins got elected.
Craig Watkins, the kid from Oak Cliff, will become Dallas County's next district attorney.
As your DA, not only am I responsible for prosecuting those bad guys, but I'm responsible for making sure that if someone innocent comes down to the courthouse, we're not gonna be down there trying to put them in jail for a crime they didn't commit.
I was elected in 2006. I was the first African-American DA elected in the whole state of Texas. Being a person of color, obviously, I have issues with law enforcement. It didn't work for me and people that look like me for a long time. And so I wanted to come in and make sure that law enforcement worked for a community that basically distrusted it. The thought process was that a DA was to protect a conviction at all cost. When I came in, I looked at these cases to make sure that if a person was wrongfully convicted, that they got their fair day in court and they would be exonerated. And also we would actually go and pursue the actual person that committed the crime.
In 2007, Watkins created a special unit to re-examine those cases. He named it the Conviction Integrity Unit, and they started unpacking case files.
The unpacking of the case starts with getting all the documents that we can that are available. Normally, that's a transcript of the trial, so we can see what happened. Jim would handle a substantial amount of the factual investigation, and then Cynthia will handle the legal side. And then we'll all get together and we pose questions to each other so that we challenge the validity of the conviction.
Within a year, the unit was investigating 400 guilty verdicts and they cleared six men through the use of DNA technology.
On TV, exoneration, exoneration, exoneration. And I'm like, oh yeah, you know, it may be trying to happen for some of us, so I went to back writing letters again to people.
But the real test was clearing someone like Christopher Scott.
Christopher Scott's case is one of the first cases that we actually investigated from the standpoint of eyewitness identification. It was a non-DNA case.
Craig Watkins was putting his career and the credibility of the conviction integrity unit on the line.
If I go with this case, based upon this subjective information, eyewitness identification, am I going to ruin the opportunity for us to pursue this program that we have if this individual actually committed the crime and it's found out years later? And so the first thing I did, first time I've ever done this, was I wanted to go down and talk to him face to face. He was in his, you know, jail uniform, looked him in the eye and asked him. And, you know, I truly believed him when he answered the questions that he didn't commit the crime.
Scott's next break came when he met a lawyer from the Dallas County Public Defender's Office.
Good to see you.
Nice to see you too.
Nice.
Thank you.
Michelle Moore was racking up a string of exoneration victories in Dallas.
When I was in prison, I seen Michelle Moore on TV getting guys exonerated. And I was saying, like, if I can get this lady to represent me, I'd probably get exonerated. Like a week later, I get a letter from Dallas County, Craig Watkins' office, saying Michelle Moore was appointed my counsel.
And we talked, and he's like, I didn't do it. I didn't do it. I've said that from the beginning. I kind of lost hope for a little bit and stopped fighting as much, but I didn't do it. I've never told anybody I did it. I am completely innocent, and I have maintained that the entire time. Even when I lost hope with the system, I maintained my innocence.
The unthinkable was happening in Dallas. Public defenders and prosecutors were working side by side on a wrongful conviction case. Word was spreading throughout the system that Christopher Scott's case was mishandled and another person had gotten away with the crime. Christopher Scott finally caught a break when an inmate serving time for another gun-related crime came forward to identify himself. This was the man police should have been looking for. His name is Alonzo Hardy.
Hardy had written a letter to the courts and said, I did this. I was not the shooter, but I was the good eyes. I'm sick, and, you know, I want to clear my conscience on this.
Next, Hardy gave up the shooter. He was a man named Michael Anderson, a.k.a. D-Mike. You can see how a frightened witness making a cross-racial identification could confuse Claude Simmons with D-Mike. Michelle Moore arranged to meet Alonzo Harding.
He was able to take us through going to buy crack at the house previously, kind of scoping out the house because they had actually seen a lot of money in the house, going back to the house to steal money.
During the trial and during the initial investigation, his name, Alonzo Hardy, and Michael Anderson's names had come up in the investigation that they were known to be committing these robberies, that they were robbing Mexican drug dealers in the area.
I've got to give a lot of accolades to Jim Hammond because looking at the scene and going through the ballistic stuff, he's like, well, there's stuff is missing, and then...
They knocked on the door, they opened the door. From what Alonzo Hardy says is that they recognized D-Mike from the previous robbery, and Alonzo Hardy was standing by the door to the left, and the victim shot at him, and the bullet pierced his coat. It didn't strike his body at all, but pierced his coat. And then as he swung the gun toward D-Mike shot him.
Hammond reinvestigated the scene and put the confession and the evidence together. And after 13 years, the first non-DNA exoneration case in Dallas was cracked. Could this mean freedom for Christopher Scott and Claude Simmons?
Claude Simmons and Christopher Scott were both in the same courtroom receiving life sentences 12 years ago. Today, their names cleared.
The evidence supports a final finding of fact showing that each defendant in these two cases are actually innocent.
We made a mistake in the criminal justice system. We convicted two individuals for capital murder in crimes in which they didn't commit.
I wasn't angry. I wasn't bitter about the situation. I was happy. I had my time to be mad in prison. I had my time to be bitter in prison. It was no time for that because I didn't want nothing to stagnate my growth of what I'm trying to do. I have plans that I had to try to foresee and make happen.
When Christopher Scott was released from prison, the state of Texas compensated him with $1 million settlement. He never forgot what it was like to wear that white jumpsuit every day. So he built a store and filled it with color and style.
It's gonna look good. We'll put that
and when an inmate is exonerated, or if they serve time with Scott, he helps them to get back some of their dignity with a fresh set of clothes.
And them pants that go with your shoes.
Yeah, that'll work, though. Mm-hmm. I look good, don't I? I look good.
Christopher's means well. Could you ever thought, like when we was in prison, glad you're out, you know what I mean? For real.
But the store is really home base for the system-changing work he does with a band of fellow exonerees, each falsely identified by an eyewitness.
Stephen Phillips, 26 years for a crime he didn't commit. Johnny Lindsay, 25 years for a crime he didn't commit.
They call themselves the House of Renewed Hope.
And what we do is we receive many, many letters of individuals that's in prison that's claiming their innocence. And we read their cases, we read their trial transcripts, and if we feel like it's something that we can do or should be done, we dig deeper into their case.
Christopher Scott's exoneration was a watershed moment for the criminal justice system in the city of Dallas. The police department, under intense public pressure, decided to change their outmoded eyewitness identification procedures.
Basically, it was an opportunity to look at the research that was out there.
Ron Waldrop is the former assistant police chief. He helped to spearhead the changes in procedure.
We showed them the facts. Here's how many have been overturned by DNA, and here's what the research said.
The first step was to embrace the findings of researchers like Jen Dysart. In 2013, Dysart, along with Ron Waldrop, helped to publish a groundbreaking National Institute of Justice report. The report breaks down the steps that law enforcement agencies should take in order to make their eyewitness identification procedures more accurate and fair.
We agreed in Dallas Police Department to be a test city. We took every step that the research had indicated was beneficial and we put it in the system.
Ron Waldrop moved the Dallas Police Department away from what are considered bad practices, like the ones we've seen so far in the experiment. So to recap, the laptop was stolen. Investigators showed the witnesses a six-pack lineup. This guy picked number six, the wrong suspect. This woman was coerced into picking number five.
Now, the way we changed it in Dallas, they would prepare a lineup, and then they would give all the admonitions.
So you're gonna view a group of photographs. Keep in mind that it's just as important to clear innocent people as to identify guilty people.
It's things that you tell the witness that are important for them to know.
The people that you see in the photograph might not look exactly like they did at the time that you saw them because some features might change. The person who committed the crime may or may not be in the photographs that you see. So okay. Keep that in mind.
Advise the person looking at the lineup that no matter if they identify anybody or not, the police are going to continue to investigate.
And regardless of whether you make an identification, the investigation is going to continue.
Okay.
They would take it to a blind administrator.
So that's when the officer, detective, who's showing the images or the people shouldn't know who the suspect is in the case.
Mm-hmm.
And that's so that they can't unconsciously or consciously influence the witness in any way.
Then they show them to them sequentially, one at a time.
No.
There can't be any unintentional outside influence. And they have to make an independent decision on each photograph as they go through.
No. Witnesses are less likely to make a mistake. No. Pick an innocent person if the images are just shown one at a time. No. And that gets us to the fifth recommendation. Ask the witness immediately after they make their identification how certain they are.
No.
And how confident are you?
Pretty confident.
Yeah. Turns out this witness is right. The suspect was not in the lineup.
I mean, these seem like such basic and obvious things. It's surprising that everyone doesn't do it. Is there resistance or is it education?
It's a little bit of both.
being frank, the resistance across the country is more from prosecutors than it is from law enforcement. You know, law enforcement want the tools that are the most effective to help them with their job, and they're generally speaking receptive to these kinds of reforms.
You're not going to eliminate mistakes by eyewitness and identification. You just try to make it as good a system as you can and minimize the mistakes, and then understand that mistakes can still be made and rely on other investigative means to try to resolve them before anybody spends their life in prison for something they didn't do.
Since the day George Toca was arrested, convicted, and sentenced for the killing of his best friend, Eric Batiste, he has said he did not do it.
By 2010, after 24 years behind bars, momentum was finally building for George Toca. He was granted a post-conviction hearing to present new evidence at criminal court in New Orleans. The hearing was the culmination of years of amateur detective work by his sister Sandy, who never lost hope.
I never even second-guessed it. I never even doubted.
With the Innocence Project's help, Sandy coaxed a number of reluctant witnesses to come forward, many who pointed a finger at another suspect.
When you look at his physical description, it exactly matches the description initially given by the two witnesses to the crime.
June 16, 2010, George Toca's post-conviction relief hearing opened in New Orleans. Four new witnesses testified another man shot Eric Batiste. Nine affidavits were presented. Toca's lawyers made the case that research on cross-racial identifications proved them to be biased. Then Judge Julian Parker ended the hearing.
Tearful testimony today from the victim's family was not enough to grant George Toca a chance at freedom. Several other witnesses said that another man confessed, but Judge Julian Parker dismissed those claims.
The judge literally sit there after all this, I got these people to write, come forward, write affidavits and everything. And the judge literally sit there and told everybody in the court, he don't know where they coming from after 20-something years, but he don't know who paid them off, as if I had went to these people and literally paid them money to come forward.
The state actually argued in that hearing that it was a conspiracy of people from the Lafitte Housing Project to free one of their own.
We all wanted to just start screaming and shouting in it, but we knew not to do that because we'd probably be locked up. So we left the courthouse with that type of feeling that he was trying to give us some consideration, but as far as we was concerned, he gave us no consideration.
The Innocence Project has filed an appeal. But as every year passes George Toca by, it gets harder and harder to prove his innocence.
This shall pass authority.
Clearly, it's a misidentification. That's the only thing that the state put on to wrongfully convict me of this crime. I believe in the truth, you know, and that's what's been keeping me going. And so I know I'm innocent. I know God knows I'm innocent. And I believe in, you know, God is just God, and I believe in the truth.
I'm going to keep fighting. I'm gonna keep fighting to the day he's released.
We're speaking with authority that this city has to change.
I'm gonna keep searching. If somewhere, something, I need to talk to the councilman. I need to talk to the senator. I'm not gonna quit.
Hallelujah. You know, the wheels of justice move slow, but they do move. And I just think at the right time, right place, it could be fixed, but it's up to us to fix it, because that's why we have to go out there and vote to put the right people in the right positions to make the changes that we need in our criminal justice system.